Good night and welcome to another edition of UNCUT. Tonight, my guest is Dr. Colin Young. He's the executive director of the 5Cs Center, and those 5Cs stand for the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center. And it's a great honor that Belizeans take for granted that we have this center based in Belize. And we have him here tonight. I know that when you watch UNCUT, you expect some raw politics or something like that, but we have Dr. Young here tonight to talk about climate change because we are on the verge of a meeting called COP26, the Conference of the Parties 26 in Glasgow, Scotland. And, you know, most people would say it's irrelevant, there's just one more meeting. But in fact, for our region, which you will be taking the message of our region, this is an existentially important meeting. So from the outset, Doc, why should anyone care in the public about COP26?
Thank you, Jules, and good night to the listeners. COP26 should matter to every person, especially those of us in this part of the world, in Belize, in the Caribbean, because it represents the last best chance for the world to agree on taking certain actions that would limit global temperatures from increasing to a point where it causes even more devastation that we're seeing today. Climate change literally impacts everybody's life. While you might not know that what you're experiencing, if you're a farmer, that you're having more droughts that is causing you not to be able to produce your crops, or that you're seeing your beach erode, that impacts you. And we now know from the science that the world is warming faster than we had thought. And as a result of that, there are certain things that the international community, especially the large emitters, the large countries, the US, China, Brazil, EU, all of these countries, that they have to do. This conference of parties, this COP, is about getting these countries to agree to do what they've promised.
Yeah, because so far they have made empty promises from 2009.
Lots of empty promises.
Again in 2015, a succession of empty promises from the developed countries.
Yes, and so there's a lot of talk and no action. Meanwhile, countries like us in the Caribbean, we're suffering the consequences of climate change.
So let's explain, because climate change, just explain it in the most basic terms, because when you came here tonight, the climate changed. I don't know if you have superpowers, but when you arrived here, it was dry and now it's pouring rain. But that is not climate change. What does climate change really mean, Doc?
Okay, in order to answer that question, I think viewers will need to understand the difference between weather and climate. So weather is what you experience when you go outside. Right now it's raining.
Yeah.
So that's the weather. Then it can, tomorrow will be sunny, it will be cool, it could be wet, it could be dry. That's your weather. Climate is what we refer to as the pattern in the weather over a long period of time. Normally we use 30 years. So by that I mean, we know that in June, what type of weather do you expect?
Raining.
Rain. And in May, March?
Dry. And hot.
Dry and hot. So over time, we've come to know that it's predictable that in June, rains right. come, in March, dry season. That is patterns over a long period of time. Climate change now refers to when those patterns become out of whack and unpredictable. It rains when it's supposed to be dry. It floods when it's supposed to be dry, and you get rains in the dry season. But in addition to that, there are a number of associated impacts that come from when you have global warming, which refers to when the Earth's temperature is getting hotter. As a result of that, you have things like the ice caps melting, so sea level is rising, you have ocean waters getting hotter, you have stronger hurricanes, you have more droughts, you have more rain, you have more diseases. All of these things is what we refer to as climate change.
We're seeing some flooding footage from October, that was 2015, that's October, actually October 17th or 18th, 2015. We're now at October 20th, 2021, and that footage happened almost exactly 5 years ago when we had that epic downfall of 10 inches of rain in the city. And that was unseasonable, and then we know that last year we had these hurricanes in November. So it's the same thing you're talking about, that they, like those type of rains, if they happen, should have happened in June. But there we were in October seeing these epic rains. That was in 2015. So what you're saying is that everything gets mixed up.
Everything gets mixed up and unpredictable. And you start to see things that normally you hear people say that once in 100 years becoming, you know, once every couple of years.
Right.
Instead of one in every 10 years, it's happening more frequently.
Yes, last year in November, we had generational floods, correct. Unprecedented floods.
Correct. And in some years in the dry season, we've had record floods. So one of the effects of climate change is that because the Earth's temperature is warming, the atmosphere is warming, warmer air holds more water. That water comes from when it's being evaporated from lakes, oceans, rivers, the ground. And as a result, you will get, within a 12-hour period, some crazy amounts of rainfall. 10 inches in 12 hours, 7 inches in 8 hours. Sometimes you hear about, you stop measuring rainfall in inches and you use feet. Those are all associated impacts of climate change. They occur at a rate that is unprecedented.
Now, how will your trip to Glasgow, Scotland matter at all and fix this or contribute to fixing it, because we know it can't be just fixed with a magic wand?
Well, there are really three major outcomes that CARICOM would like to get from the COP. And I say like to get from the COP because it is a negotiation. The same way how we have countries in the Caribbean who would like a particular outcome, you have countries who are trying to preserve the status quo. And so you get over 190 countries will be represented at this COP. The interests of these countries are varied. They may not want the same thing that we want in the Caribbean. For example, they might want to continue to use coal. They might want to continue to burn fossil fuels at a rate when the science is telling you that if you want to stop the Earth's temperature from rising to 1.5, you need to cut global emissions by 45% by 2030. And you have to get to net zero by 2050. What do I mean by net zero? It means that whatever amount of greenhouse gases you're putting into the atmosphere, that you're removing the same amount.
Right.
So there's a net zero on it. So when we go there now, and the CARICOM negotiates as part of a group called the Alliance of Small Island States. And what we want is to say to the international community, the big emitters, the G20, G7, G20, look, you need to step up your actions to cut global emissions by 45% by 2030, and you need to announce that by 2023, the latest. Secondly, you have to commit to this net zero by 2050. And most importantly for us, what we are saying to them, look, in Paris, you promise to deliver $100 billion a year to small island developing states and LDCs, and you've not met your promise. You've missed it miserably.
Right.
In the meanwhile, we are suffering the consequences. So put your money where your mouth is and deliver a minimum of $100 billion. Those are the two big things we want. And the third one is that since the Paris Agreement in 2015, there is a number of rules that need to be agreed to by the international community. It's called the Paris Rule Book. And that rule book there are three outstanding issues that really need to get fixed. One on carbon markets, one on transparency, which you think would be an easy one because, you know, everybody wants to be transparent. And the third one is what we call common time frames, where we report at the same time. So in order for the Paris Agreement to get the teeth,
right,
you need the rules. And the rules have to be strong, because if the rules are weak, then you don't get what you're looking for.
You get empty promises.
Empty promises. So those are the three things. When we go to COP, the prime ministers and the ministers of environment and the ministers of foreign affairs, any ministers who are going to go to the COP, you would hear them echoing that at a minimum we want these three outcomes that are favorable to the region. Because the Caribbean Community Climate Change Center since 2009 has been promoting and pushing this 1.5 to stay alive. We are saying that if...
Explain what that means, 1.5 degrees Celsius.
Celsius. And for those who think in Fahrenheit, that's 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit. But that is a threshold. Right now, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change has said that since 1850 to now, the Earth's temperature has already increased by 1.2 degrees Celsius.
Right. And from 1970 to now, it has accelerated the most
correct
in human history, or at least in probably 12,000 years.
And so that what we're trying to do is to say, because the UN had published a report that was a special report on 1.5, and it said that if we get to 1.5, you will see the worsening of floods, worsening of droughts. You will see a 70 to 90% reduction in coral reefs. You would see more droughts. You would see greater sea level rise. And for us, you'll see warmer oceans. Belize is a country that has the second largest barrier reef in the world. Imagine that 70 to 90% reduction in corals. What that would do to fishing, what that would do to tourism. Nobody comes from the US or England to come and snorkel on a reef that has dead coral bleach corals. So these are real things that are going to happen. So we are trying.
This is an Earth crisis.
It's a humanity crisis and an Earth crisis. In fact, so much so that the UN Secretary General had said that declared a code red for humanity. That this is not a climate change. It's not a hoax. It's not perpetrated by anybody ill intent. It's happening. And so when you look across Belize, for example, or the whole Caribbean, and you're seeing the amount of coastal erosion happening, you're seeing that we are getting Category 5 hurricanes as though they come out of nowhere, that they're some of the strongest storms on Earth that we've never before seen. We're seeing temperatures that are higher than we've experienced, and they're lasting longer than we've ever seen. You're seeing drought that are multi-year stress. All of these things, as bad as they are now, are nothing compared to what is projected if we were to get to 1.5 degree. And right now, based on all of the commitments from all of the countries that have submitted what they will plan to do to keep global temperatures below 1.5, the actual number is 2.7. So if everybody does what they say they're going to do, that they have submitted to COP26, we are still on a path to arrive at 2.7 degrees Celsius.
So 2.7 degrees Celsius means that it will warm up, converting that to Fahrenheit, 2.7 degrees Celsius. Let me just do the conversion here. 2.7 C is 3.9 Fahrenheit.
Yes.
I'm just saying that if they do everything they say they'll do, we will still heat up by that amount.
And that is absolutely disastrous for small countries like us in the Caribbean. We maintain that we need to keep global temperatures beneath the 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit because of the impact. So if it's going to be so bad at 1.5, a half a degree more than that to 2 is even more devastating. Imagine now you're going now over 2.
Okay, so now Gaston Brown is the chair of the Alliance of Small Island States. He has said that in the Financial Times, he said that considering the stakes, the developing countries, should not expect us to be anything other than implacable in pursuing our demands. Good, sounds great. However, when a small country talks about being implacable, large countries scoff. How do we issue a consequence to these people? How do we force them into a position where they must act in a consequential, decisive way that will save our small island developing states?
As you rightly said, the Prime Minister of Antigua and Barbuda is the current chair of EOSIS, and it means that there is strength in numbers. So while we are small individually, Belize and Antigua and Barbuda and the rest of CARICOM are part of the EOSIS and SIDS. And there are about 40 nations that are part of that. And so as a bloc, we negotiate in this group. And that is where the pressure comes. So there are, you know, 15 countries in CARICOM, and there are small islands in the Pacific and in the Indian Ocean. And we try to ensure that we are speaking with one voice in a number of issues. But for a long time, Jules, even though we have been making clarion calls for the world to act, they have not been acting at the speed and at the scale that we needed them to. What is slightly different this time around that causes for some cautious optimism is that climate change is starting to impact even the developed countries at a scale that is also unprecedented. You see the flooding and the number of people dying in Germany. You see the forest fires in Greece. You're seeing what's happening in the States right now in terms of forest fires in places like Oregon and Washington State and California and so on. And so nobody is being spared from the ravages of climate change. And so in a sense, the pigeons are coming home to roost. Part of what we're hoping is that they're now starting to experience what we have been experiencing for well over a decade. And in an effort to also help themselves, they can then take policies that we are calling for that will also help countries like us in the Caribbean. But when you are small, when you don't have any natural resources that the wealthy countries need, then you rarely have any bargaining chips. The only chips that you might have is when there is a time for some kind of vote. When they would want 15 CARICOM members to support them, and whether they would say, well, in order for this vote, we will deliver X amount of financing to assist, or, you know, we will take the... So it's a kind of horse trading that happens on the negotiations.
Some moral suasion will not work.
Well, we are
These countries are inherently immoral. So
yeah.
They put money before everything else.
Well, Prime Minister Mia Mottley from Barbados at the in her UN address called for strategic moral leadership. And really, I think that's nicely summarized what it's needed, because if they make decisions solely on money and looking at short-term profits, we're not going to get the kind of ambition that we need. And so there has to be some moral leadership that we're seeing. And we're seeing the UK starting to take steps to lead. When the administration, last US administration was in power, you know, they had come out of the Paris Agreement. The US is responsible for a large share of the carbon dioxide emissions. In fact, the US, China, and the EU, just those three are responsible for 42% of all of the greenhouse gas emissions. So we need leadership. President Biden has committed to scale up actions, but as you see, he's having challenges in his Senate in the US today, where actions are not at the level that they need to be. So we are hoping that with a huge amount of voices, including youths, including women, including other vulnerable groups, NGOs, civil society, the private sector, that there would be the type of pressure on the political leaders to act, and act now. This is the last decade that we have to keep 1.5 within reach. And to be very clear, we want, as CARICOM, to keep global temperatures below 1.5, because at 1.5, it's going to be bad. It's going to be considerably worse than now. So it's not as though we want to get to 1.5, we want to stay below 1.5.
Right. So my question is, if we want to bring this back home, because I know that in Belize, we live well, all things considered. We are not climate refugees, not yet. While people live in conditions that are poor and intolerable, and I know this. When you see what is happening to other parts of the world where they are losing so much of their, island nations in particular, are losing so much of their mass due to climate change, those conditions are what create climate refugees. I want to look, we have these pictures of Monkey River that you sent. I want to bring it home. We also have the pictures of, Lance, if you can bring up the picture of Saltwater Key that the comparison, a a salt water key that Dr. Young sent us earlier. While you look for that, right here we're looking at Monkey River Dock, a place you have visited many times in your former life as a lecturer. Mm-hmm. Explain to me what we are seeing here in Monkey River.
What we're seeing, that picture right there is the cemetery in the burial ground in Monkey River. And you can see, this is almost like Sisyphus, Jules, where they have a couple of sandbags and some tires that villagers are desperately trying to stop the sea from encroaching on the burial ground. At current rates, the sea is going to take cover the...
How long ago were these photos taken?
This picture was taken in 2017.
Well, that gone.
And these two graves right there are actually partially in the water. When there is high tide, the waves actually get where you see the sandbags, which is undercutting that tomb.
Right.
What you're seeing is that one of the effects of global warming is that sea levels are rising. And they're rising at a rate that starts to cause beaches and coastlines to erode at a rate that is unknown and unprecedented to people. If you show the picture with...
You have the saltwater key image yet, guys?
That's the one with the beach.
I think they'll bring it up shortly. I don't think they have.
So that one is a house that you can see.
That's Monkey River.
Monkey River again. That's clear. It's already under the house. Now, Monkey River has already lost almost over 2,000 feet of village. So they've lost. There used to be a school out in the front. They've lost three rows of houses. And as you can see, the encroachment, that house is just a matter of time before that will disappear as well. Now, the rule of thumb with sea level rise is that every 1 inch of sea level rise floods 100 inches. And so what you're seeing is that some of the projections for sea level rise, if temperatures continue to increase and we get to 1.5, we know that Belize is at sea level, Belize City. Today, driving here, there was a lot of flooding on Hyde's Lane and some other streets.
Are we able to cue the flood footage from today, guys? The flood footage from today, that's a Hyde's Lane. That's a Hyde's Lane picture. That looks like it's from Credit Union, right?
So you can already, we call these nuisance flooded, because when you get a lot of rain, plus it's high tide, you get the flooding. Now, imagine this happening all the time and frequent. Imagine what it does to your property values. Imagine what it does to the residents that have to live in these conditions. And this is nothing compared to what some of the models are suggesting will happen if we don't curtail global temperatures.
So now we're seeing the saltwater key images.
This picture was taken by Tony Rath, and they're 10 years apart. And you can see the top picture is 10 years prior to the one at the bottom. Same mangrove tree that is in the top and the bottom. And you can see all of that beach was completely eroded from rising sea levels.
And we have the other photo there of the British High Commissioner, Therese Rath, sitting on a beach chair. And we see her there sitting. Can you set it up for us, Doc?
Yes, I think what Tony was trying to do here, and I think it's a very powerful picture, in that the pictures are 10 years apart, and Mrs. Rath is sitting in the bottom picture where she was in the top picture. And so you can see all of that beach has disappeared.
Completely so she's
gone.
Sitting at the same place, and she's completely submerged and at distance.
Correct, and you see no sand.
Right, the
right?
Beach is gone,
you see no sand. In fact, you see where the palm trees are in the top. The palm trees are the same trees in the bottom. So what I love about this picture is that it communicates the slow but persistent march of the sea that is going to erode coastline, erode beaches. Now imagine if that was your land that you had. Imagine what has happened to the property value.
Right, you lose value, you lose
value. And now this is also what's going to happen on the coastlines. that you're seeing it starting to place in San Pedro, you're seeing it in Kikaka, you're seeing it in Monkey River, you're seeing it in Dangriga, you're seeing it in Placencia, you're seeing it in Riversdale. It is a march where the sea, because it's increasing in height, is starting to erode the beaches and come over land. Now, what does that mean? Because to make it more practical, when you travel from Belize City to go to Belmopan, right by the coastal, the Coast Guard, I think that's mile 3.
Yeah.
When you look to the left going up, the sea is literally only a couple thousand feet out from there. But that is pretty much flat land. So a small increase in sea level rise will now bring that sea right into the highway. And eventually, the question is, it will threaten the passability of that highway. And that's just there. But Belize City, as you know, is also right. Flat places, like in the south. So what will have to happen? The government will have to find a lot of money to build seawalls. The drains will no longer be able to drain the kind of water from the city. And you would have to start building elevated highways out of the city. Those cost hundreds of millions of
right.
dollars.
And we just invested a huge amount in a very vulnerable piece of land, which is from the Halova to the airport. It's a CDB project, climate resilient. We know that they had climate mitigation elements in it, but it's just a strip of land between the sea and the river. We know what's going to happen there. Like, obviously, they should have built an elevated highway, but that is, again, hundreds of millions of dollars, unless you're building a causeway. That's what we're going to talk about after the break. We'll take our first commercial break. When we come back, we'll be with Dr. Colin Young again. We want to thank our sponsors, Bennis Home Center, Belize Medical Associates, Belize Tax Services Department, Cellular World, Creative Marketing, Mikado Textile Palace, Ministry of Health and Wellness, and the Quick Stop Finance Center. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after this commercial break.
Welcome to the good life.
Like we always do with this time.
Live the good life, where you will find quality and savings on these products and more, only at Benny's.
BMA, Belize Medical Associates, they'll see you through and they will always care for you. BMA, Belize Medical Associates, they're there for you.
No need to visit the Belize Tax Service and stand in long lines. Easily register your business today by visiting www.irisbelize.bts.gov.bz. When registered, Iris Belize allows you to prepare and pay for your tax services all from your fingertips, using your preferred bank, from your office or home. You will be supported with clear communication and prompt response time with a secure system you can trust. Our first 40 registering companies gets a gift for your commitment in being an early user. Iris Belize, effortless, easy and efficient electronic tax services for everyone.
Honda Quick Stop Loan. Dog is so.
When time you need cash, come the Quick Stop Loan. When time you need cash, come the Quick Stop Loan. When time you need cash, come the Quick Stop Loan.
all know the importance of running water and proper drainage in your home. That's why we rely on a fully functional plumbing system. At Benny's, we have all the plumbing supplies and accessories you need. Our pipes, fittings, valves, and adapters are made from durable quality materials. Remember to wash your hands with clean running water from your faucet. We have kitchen and bathroom faucets in various styles and finishes. Whether for installation or maintenance, make sure to use recommended PVC cleaner, solvent, and Teflon tape to fix or prevent leaks. We also have the tools to get the job done. For all your residential, commercial, or industrial plumbing needs, shop at Benny's. Quality and savings.
Thanks so much for staying with us, and welcome back to the second segment of Uncut with Dr. Colin Young of the 5Cs Center in Belmopan. It's a regional climate change center. And Doc, I want to ask you, first of all, looking at COP26, because that's why you're here tonight. We're talking about this big meeting in Scotland that is unlike most meetings that Belize attends. It's not, the messages will not be lost in the ether. These are real world existential solutions that we're looking for. But I have to level the criticism. Over 20,000 delegates from 197 countries, excluding Mr. Putin, President Bolsonaro of Brazil and China. Xi Jinping of China, they won't be attending. And I've heard the Pope will only be going virtual. But I'm saying that the carbon footprint of the people attending, I understand the delegation from Belize is 30 people. I think you only need to be two, Sherry Salsal and yourself. That's what I'm saying. The leader and the president will get the message out. That's my feeling. But I'm just saying, how do you respond to that criticism that the carbon footprint of the event alone is an offense to the environment?
The estimated number of delegates are about 30,000. The COP is in fact a big meeting, and people are coming from, as you said, all over the world.
30,000 delegates. I thought it was 20.
Yeah. So it's that's not all of those. There are public sectors, civil society, foundations, donors. There's all kinds of people going to the COP. The center, for example, has a delegation of five that is going to the COP. And so, not to make it quite technical, the issue is that at one point, because of the COVID pandemic, we were thinking of the possibility of having a virtual COP. But virtual COPs with the time zone differences that are all over the world, and the fact that there is not like when you're face to face, when you could stare somebody in the eye and level with them and hopefully try to convince them, if I'm nothing else, in terms of moral persuasion. The small island developing states and CARICOM was largely of the view that if we were not there in person to put as that additional amount of pressure, we wouldn't succeed in getting the big emitters to act. So while it is that there would be a substantial carbon footprint, and there are mechanisms through which delegations can offset that carbon and make contributions to various entities, and that's being done. We felt largely that if we weren't there in the room, that the outcomes we would get from COP26 would not be favorable or as favorable to SID. So that is, it's a trade-off like everything else, and hopefully by our presence there, that you're in the same room and people can't disengage as they would if they're on a virtual call. If I'm on a Teams call and we're all there, I could be, playing Monopoly from all I care in the back end. So so because these issues are contentious, and they're always contentious.
You need that.
I was in the room in Paris when the Paris Declaration was gaveled through by the president in France. And I remember that scene very well. You had Al Gore, you had all of the leaders of the G20 on the floor standing up, talking to each other, and people on the phone calling somebody. And ultimately they arrived at an agreement on the last issues, and he hit the gavel, and that was the Paris Agreement.
Right.
That can't happen virtually.
I see what you're saying. So
you see?
It has a certain energy.
Correct.
So good. We understand that organizationally. Now I want to bring it back again, as we did in the last segment. Last segment, we talked about these very specific things with coastal erosion. If we can look at it from the broader picture now, start with the ice caps melting, the polar caps melting. Then let's move on to talk about the acid rain and how that affects the seas. Then how the warm seas affect the fish that we eat and that we depend on, and the snapper that we love. That will be swimming somewhere else because the temperature of the water is too irregular. So if you can, please give us that broad picture.
I love that you start out with that, because climate change does have, it's all of these feedbacks or these connections between various things. As you rightly said, because the Earth's temperature is rising, that is causing the polar ice caps to melt.
Once, so then people will say, but that's not happening here.
It's far from here,
it's
right?
Far from here. But it's at the top of the world, and we're right in the middle.
Top of the world and the bottom of the world, right? So Antarctica and Arctic Circle, and we are seeing that there are unprecedented melting of these glaciers happening.
It doesn't affect us. We will still feel good.
But it does, because what's happening is the sea level is rising. And we just showed you some pictures as to what's happening to beaches and to erosion.
So then, when all that ice melts,
well,
you're saying it raises sea levels here?
Yes, all over the world.
Okay.
In some places, it's higher than others. So that's the first part of the issue. Melting of polar ice caps causes the sea levels around the world to rise. Now, we are hopeful that all of the ice caps don't melt, because those projections are just absolutely crazy in terms of how far sea level will go. But once, the other thing is that because the ocean temperatures, the atmosphere temperatures is increasing, so are the oceans. And when the oceans warm, the temperature, you have marine heat waves. Just like how you have heat waves on land, you have these heat waves in the ocean. Now, oceans support coral reefs. Corals don't like hot water. They like warm water, but not hot water. And what we're seeing is that the oceans is warming at an alarming rate. Why is that bad? That's bad because if the corals live in water that is too hot, they bleach, they become white, they lose all of that pretty beautiful color, and they turn white because they kick out the algae that lives with them. And corals, as we all know, support a thriving population of fish. Not only fish that tourists and Belizeans love to see when they snorkel, but fish for food.
Right.
And corals, without a healthy coral reef, you won't have a healthy fish population, which means that it threatens food security. Now, in addition to that, remember why the Earth is warming. It's warming because you have these, what we call these greenhouse gases, things like carbon dioxide.
Man-made or woman-made emissions.
Yeah, when we burn oil, whether we are driving a car or for electricity, we're releasing carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. The atmosphere carbon dioxide is increasing at an alarming rate. Now, that carbon dioxide is being absorbed by the oceans. When you have carbon dioxide mixing with seawater, you have what is called carbonic acid that is produced.
Okay.
So everybody knows acid tends to burn, it tends to erode things. And so what the oceans are becoming more acidic. It's called ocean acidification, meaning that the pH level, or it's becoming more acidic. Why is that bad? That's bad because coral reefs require calcium carbonate, which is a mineral from the salt water that they need to build their skeletons, and anything that has a seashell, that is required to build their seashells. So without the carbonate in the water, which the acid destroys, then when there's a storm, when there's a strong wave, it destroys the corals and it breaks things apart, so it's more brittle. So there you can see global warming, ocean temperature rising, causing atmospheric temperature rising, sea temperature rising, impacting coral reefs.
You can see some of the bleaching right there.
Impacting fishing, livelihood, tourism, all of that. So that is how all of these things are what we call effects of climate change. What the IPCC report is saying that was produced in August is that these bleaching events that we're seeing now that are going to become more frequent to the point where under a 1.5 degree scenario, they're going to decrease by 70 to 90%. When you go from 1.5 degrees Celsius to 2, it's going to go to 98%. Right? So just think about that.
But
Caribbean countries are countries that all depend substantially on oceans and tourism.
But so I want the viewing public to understand it in the terms that I do, that it is a very cruel global injustice that we in the global south suffer at the hands of the excess and indiscipline of the global north and the absolute more immorality of this, because they can, to a greater degree, insulate themselves from the shocks of these climatic changes or these environmental changes. Exactly. But we can't. We live very close to nature, and we live on the edge of being extremely poor as well. So we live right between those extremes. And they are literally taking food out of our mouth in terms of earnings and in terms of the actual food that we eat, the fish that we eat, that so many of us depend on to eat.
In fact, you're right. In fact, what we're saying is that it's an issue of climate justice. Because, Jules, what is so alarming about this whole situation we find ourselves in, the Caribbean, about 45 million people that live in this part of the world, our greenhouse gas emission, meaning our contribution to the problem, is less than 1%. Less than 1%. So you have the EU, you have the United States of America, and you have China. Those three countries are responsible for 42% of the carbon dioxide emissions. When you think of the G20, those 20 countries, they are responsible for 80%. The bottom 100 other countries are responsible for only 3.6%. So what I'm saying here is that we are at the front line of this war on climate change, but we are not the ones causing it. They're the ones causing it. They're the ones that have polluted the environment. They're the ones that have pursued a development path that has destroyed nature, have converted their natural resources, and the byproduct of that is greenhouse gas emissions.
And we pay the price.
We are paying the price. And not only that, now you're making it impossible for us to access the little bit of money that you've promised to flow to this part of the world. Because developing countries need about $3 trillion to implement the plans that they've put forth to the convention. And the developed countries since Paris had promised $100 billion. Well, they've missed the deadline and they've missed the quantum. They have not lived up to their promise. Meanwhile, since 2015, do you know how many disasters has happened in the Caribbean since then? How many hurricanes, how many floods, how many droughts, how many beaches have been further eroded? How many livelihoods have been threatened? Just last year, you heard that there was a drought in the north where farmers would have lost in the order of $30, $40 million in crops. That is real.
Right.
That is real. And
we had the forest fires that we were showing a short while ago as well. Those epic forest fires in the Mountain Pine Ridge,
Baca areas, yes.
And they affected the smoke inhalation in Belmopan and San Ignacio.
So the link with human health, and why is forest fires becoming more important? I told you that when temperatures are rising in the atmosphere, there is a greater amount that is of water that is being evaporated from soils, evaporated from water bodies like rivers and lakes, and so it dries out the soils. And when it dries out the soils, the forests also become drier. And when the forest become drier, it burns when from lightning strikes or from body lighting a fire. So all of these things are connected, because last 2 years ago, there was an unbelievably large fire season in Cayo. I had to leave Cayo because of the smoke. People who has asthma, they would suffer under these kinds of things. So what you're seeing, rainforests are rainforests because for majority of the year, they're wet and they don't normally burn. Now what you're seeing is that they're so dry that they're burning. And when you burn forests, guess what else is happening? All of the carbon that is stored in those forests is now being released into the atmosphere, compounding the problem with fossil fuels burning. So one of the things that Belize, for example, along with Suriname and Guyana, that have large amount of rainforests, those forests serve as a sink because they take up the CO2 from the air, and we get oxygen from that, but that is how they would grow. But now when you burn forests, you are now releasing that carbon that is stored. And then plus the fossil fuels that we are burning, that goes into the atmosphere. And while Belize is small, relative to, say, Brazil, the deforestation that is happening in Brazil, along with all of the emissions of other greenhouse gases, is making the situation worse.
Now, we know that in his statement, Gaston Brown, who is the chair of EOSIS, has said that international financial institutions must make fair the long-term framework on public debt, de-risking investment in small island developing states. Debt service suspension and special drawing rights are good, but temporary and uneven in their impact, as access is based on illogical criteria to which some SIDS, small island developing states, do not qualify. This entire process of how money is disbursed to compensate for these, for the environmental changes we're going through, has to be revisited.
Completely, because it's not working. What has happened is that the developed countries has promised that they would put certain amount of money that will then flow to those most vulnerable. The problem now is that you put in so much rules and so many criteria, so many bureaucracies, that it makes it almost impossible for small countries to access this money. It might take, for example, we have a project in Barbados the center is implementing on behalf of the government of Barbados. It's a $27 million project funded by the Green Climate Fund. But from the time of when we had a concept to when we actually got the monies to start, you're talking about 3.5 years. And so it's very slow, it's a trickle. And the money that we are getting compared to other parts of the world is what we'll call peanuts. So what I think people have to understand is it comes back to the point you made about climate justice. We are not begging these countries for this money. It is their obligation because they caused the problem. That is what the whole United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change is saying. You have an obligation to provide the money for countries like us to adapt to the effects of climate change. But what the Prime Minister of Antigua is saying, then don't make it so cumbersome and convoluted and complex and difficult for us to get. And that you need to ensure that this money can flow in a way that the countries can adapt to the effects of climate change, because that is your moral obligation and you promised it in the Paris Agreement, so you know you need to live up to it.
No, but here in Belize, we're also failing in our own way because we have not done anything to incentivize or create an infrastructure for electric cars. We haven't done anything to move towards zero emissions. In fact, we have more than old bus on the road. They send black smoke into the atmosphere. I understand the carbon footprint of this is negligible, but it's real. We cannot demand something of others, even if they are immoral, and they are, and not do something ourselves. We are lagging hopelessly behind in this aspect.
Well, I saw that the government of Belize recently would have submitted the updated nationally determined contributions to the convention. And in there are some ambitious goals and targets that the government will endeavor to meet. In energy and embracing renewable energy, solar, wind, and so on. as well as looking at the transport sector to decrease emissions in the transport sector. E-transport is one of the biggest topics being discussed now, in both in terms of the private sector and at the convention, because transport has a massive contribution to greenhouse gases. As you rightly said, what does it burn? It's burning diesel or gasoline. Those are fossil fuels. The byproduct of that is going to be your greenhouse gases that is causing the problem in the first place. So what you're finding is that there needs to be funding available to transition your old fleet to electric fleets.
But we know that what's going to happen also is dumping from north to south, where they have to eliminate their internal combustion engines, their fuel-driven engines, and then all of a sudden, all them car dealers at Belize who love buy junk, all of them go and say, boy, you could get a 8-cylinder Lexus for $10,000 US, which is first world junk, and then we will be incentivized by the price point to bring it to Belize, which again is perverse.
To the public policy. So what you're seeing is that the transition from fossil fuel cars and internal combustion engines to electric cars, there's a whole ecosystem, one of which is that there has to be the policy incentives where, for example, you would tax the oil, the fossil fuel cars.
Right, but we're so slow in doing this.
Higher than the small ones.
I'm saying that the Prime Minister, the former Prime Minister, Dean Barrow, announced in his Independence Day address in 2018 about electric cars, and I still only see two, the knockabout with BL logos on them. I'm saying that our pace of change in this country is glacial.
I think everything takes time, and some
takes too long, Doc.
In some cases, for sure, the transition of fleets, because there's a whole set of things that is required. For example, right now you have a gas station pretty much conveniently located where you can be sure that you travel 50 miles or so, you can find one.
Less,
right, or less, but the issue of the charging stations for the electric vehicles, right, and the when you go, you can fill up your car. I hope it doesn't take you more than, say, 15 minutes to fill up. The charging station, can you spend 45 minutes at the charging station to get your car? So there's all of that. Then there's also the point of the private sector. Because it's not just Belize, but the entire Caribbean region is grappling with how do you transition your fleet to an e-fleet, electric vehicle fleet. Public policy is needed. Financial incentives are needed. And you need to put up the infrastructure to support the change. And once you have that, then you see that there's start to buy in. Because right now, people are skeptical. It's like, yes, I don't have to buy fuel, but if I want to drive from here to Corozal, would my charge take me from Belize to Corozal?
Right, yeah.
Right? And so there's all of that has to be looked at in a holistic manner. Then obviously, I would imagine that every government would want to balance revenues that is being lost from one sector with revenues that are coming in. And so it's while sometimes we move relatively slow, it's best to deliberately move in a way that is making progress if you're putting all the pieces in together. So right now, for example, we have a project in St. Kitts and Nevis, where the government of St. Kitts and Nevis is desirous of transitioning their school buses to electric school buses.
Right.
And so you're starting out with a pilot to test this out and see how it works. Now from there you can say, okay, you can transition all government vehicles to e-fleets.
Right.
And then you make the progress. Right. And so you're learning, you're understanding what needs to be done, the public policy is being tested, being refined, and eventually, as long as you're moving in the right direction, you're making progress. But it's hard to just decide one day that you're going to go. That's a practicality of it.
Right, of course.
Right? And so right now, we also have a project with the Italians that for the government of Belize, where there was to build two charging stations in Belmopan, along with electric vehicles to pilot and to test. And you talk about BEL. BEL is testing out a couple right now. But transport is one of those big sectors that we need to decarbonize over time. And this is one of the ways that countries should be able to access money, grant money, to be able to pilot and do all of the studies that will be needed to transition your fleet to e-vehicles.
Great. So we'll take our last commercial break now. When we come back, we'll ask about something a bit closer to home, or closer to what's happening in the news right now. What does the climate change man think about all those causeways this government is talking about building? One by San Pedro, one by Independence to Placencia. We know about the one by Drunkie. Are these factors in climate change, or should climate change considerations factor into these developments? We'll ask the expert when we come back on Uncut.
The World Health Organization, cancer is the second leading cause of death globally, or one in six deaths in the past years. Are you aware that breast cancer occupies the first place of incidence as well as the highest mortality rate? As it relates to Belize, it is approximated that 49.9% of cancer patients suffer from breast cancer and 12.3% will die from this disease. Breast cancer can be treated when detected early. We encourage self-examination, but also plan your clinical breast exam with your doctor or at any hospital or clinic providing this service.
The WHO states that prostate cancer is the fourth most common cancer overall and the second most common cancer in men. Prostate cancer deaths in Belize reach 42, or 2.3% of total deaths. This cancer can be asymptomatic at the early stages and requires early active surveillance. All men over 40 should start getting a prostate test and a prostate cancer screening.
The Ministry of Health and Wellness and the Government of Belize have designated October as Cancer Awareness Month.
This disease is hurting our families and communities.
We need to join hands and raise our voices for hope for all the fighters, peace for all the survivors, and prayers for the fallen.
And comfort for the families and friends of people diagnosed with cancer.
This will sensitize our Belizean people to recognize the importance of a healthy lifestyle, early screening, and detection.
As a country, we are stronger than cancer.
Mikado announces the arrival of new designs in dress fabrics, sheeted fabrics, curtain fabrics, and a widest assortment of company uniform fabrics. We also just received the long-awaited wallpaper and 3D wallpaper with many new designs and colors to choose from. Also in our new arrivals, we have pillows, curtains, bath towels, cushions, bed cover sets, and there is so much that it's way too much to mention. Just visit Mikado at number 37 Albert Street. And remember now, at Mikado, we are the ones famous for better prices, and even in this pandemic, we are still known for the best prices. Mikado, number 37 Albert Street, your textile palace.
Hello, welcome to Samsung's awesome experience right here in Belize. Come check it out. Not sure which Samsung Galaxy A series is right for you? Touch, play, and learn about your device before you buy. Once you've purchased your device, you can now benefit from the full Samsung service experience. Your phone is covered by a one-year local warranty. This includes manufacturer defects and software and hardware issues caused by the manufacturer. Enjoy your phone with peace of mind knowing that your Galaxy is protected. And when your warranty expires, you can still bring it to our certified Samsung Repair Center. Our technicians will diagnose and repair your device with Samsung original parts and machinery. Enjoy the Samsung experience when you shop at any of our authorized partners countrywide, including Cellular World, Digi, Odette's Home Center, Debari, Quartz, Tropigas, Gadgets, and Cellular Plus. Join the Samsung experience in Belize today.
The next time you are passing Creative Marketing at 146 corner of East Collett Canal and Allenby, don't be shy. Come on in.
Welcome to Creative Marketing, where everything is possible.
We offer services like graphic designs for logos or banners or any other special request. Get designs printed on t-shirts for sporting events, special events like birthdays, or for your business. Get your polos or dress shirts officially embroidered with logos or business names. For special requests, our sewing department can get you fixed up with custom preferences. Our in-house name brands like Eliani's Collection produces uniform dress shirts and blouses for work or school. Our Z-Tech Sportswear produces fisherman shirts and dry fit polos for males or females. Ask about other items. In other departments, we produce customized banners and fin feathers. At Creative Marketing, there's so much more. So next time you're in need, come take a look. Call us at 207-2023. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Instagram. Creative Marketing, where everything is possible.
Welcome to the good life.
Like we always do with this time.
Live the good life, where you will find quality and savings on these products and more, only at Benny's.
Welcome back to our final segment of Uncut. We're talking to the executive director of the 5C Center in Belmopan about the COP26 conference he's about to attend at the start of November, the very first days of November. And Doc, I want to bring it back home again. We know that you've explained already how ice caps melting in Antarctica affect us here. And we know that while we might feel safe in our little Caribbean Sea, in fact, at the edge of the Atlantic Ocean, in fact, it's all one big sea. Mm-hmm. Everything is everything. And there are no borders in this vast, the bodies of water that surround us. But I want to ask specifically about the proposals that we have for multiple causeways. Now, we know that these are development proposals, but all of them impinge in one way or the other on the marine environment. And we're talking specifically about the one we've heard floated for Independence to Placentia and all along the all on the peninsula. Then we know that there's one for North Drunkie to Belize City and perhaps North Drunkie to Stake Bank. And then now we know that the Prime Minister has floated the idea to build a bridge and a road straight from Ishkalak over into Ambergris Key. Now, these are not necessarily climate change events, but they impact the marine resource. Is this something that, in the context of climate change, is it something that we need to look at with a keener eye?
Well, I think all development should be screened through a climate risk or a climate lens, because climate change is happening. We are feeling it, we're seeing it, we're experiencing, and all of the science is telling us that it's going to get a lot worse. And so when...
How would climate change affect the causeway? It's way up there. You just said we should have roads in the sky.
So when you would have issues, technically, in the engineering part of it would be the issue that you would have to look at, I imagine. Because remember that one of the... When you look at the State of the Caribbean Climate Report, one of the findings is that we can expect about an 80% increase in Category 4 and 5 hurricanes that will start to happen. So these are monstrous storms that would have, you know, massive tidal waves that, knock on wood, that, you know, that Belize would be spared. But when you build things, you want to build them to be able to withstand some of these extremes. It's very difficult to build things that would withstand, you know, 175 miles an hour wind and the massive tidal wave that will come with that.
I see.
Right? And so at the same time, also that you're thinking about sea level is rising. So it is always good policy for governments and NGOs and civil society.
And what we're looking at there is just Category 1 on the coast of the city. That was one of the hurricanes, I think, in 2012. But that was only a Category 1, and that wasn't the peak of it. And that's all over the seafront. And there's a brave fellow. But just saying that, you know, Belize City is particularly vulnerable. And you are saying that these superstructures were there to be built would have to be invulnerable because we're seeing storms that exceed Category 5.
Well, there's
there's superstorms.
Yeah, there is Category 5, and I think it stops there.
Right. The Saffir-Simpson scale stops there, but we know we call them superstorms.
Yeah, they're getting stronger. So I think the development, as I said, whether it's on land or whether it's offshore, the government of Belize, as well as governments in the entire Caribbean, must start to look at climate change and factor in the risks that climate change will bring to that development and plan accordingly. Climate change is not about stopping development and stopping investments. It's about making better decisions about the type of developments and investments that you're doing. And when you proceed with them, that you factored in the science of what is projected to happen in terms of sea level rise, in terms of temperature, in terms of all of these other factors. And then you, with the best advice, the best science behind it, then you get the engineers to build accordingly. In some cases, when you factor in the climate risks, you might realize that the investment is not one that you probably should proceed with, and then you act accordingly.
So, but the climate and the environmental risk, because we know that these environmental, for example, if it's a Swallow Key Manatee Sanctuary, or if it's the Bacalar Chico World Heritage Site and the turtle nesting area, we know that these environmental features are more vulnerable than ever because of climate change.
Yes. And biodiversity is another very key part of what we didn't touch on today, because climate change also impacts biodiversity. For example, if you think of the beach where there's a turtle nesting site, under the scenarios with sea level rising, eventually that beach will disappear. There will be no longer a turtle nesting site. Plus, there are all the species, the marine environment that live in the oceans, and there are sensitive ecosystem types. All of these things have to be balanced. And then you put in, you overlay the various risks, and then ultimately a decision will have to be made. The objective, I think, ought to always be, how do you find a balance that does not degrade the natural ecosystems, maintain your environmental integrity, but at the same time look at trying to ensure that development can happen. But when you start to factor in all of these things, you might come to the natural conclusion that some development ought not to occur. And if one of the roles of the center is to, from the climate change point of view, is to provide data and information for evidence-based decision-making. And if you apply that approach...
We usually use money-based decision-making.
So, but in this case, you will be served well by understanding what's happening in the world in terms of, and Belize particularly, in terms of climate change and the associated impacts, and use that to screen whatever development and investment is going to be made.
Okay, Doc, we're winding down now, and I started out saying, why does COP matter? Why does this meeting in Scotland matter? Which we have addressed during the show, but explain the important role of the media, what you feel is the important role of the media, because you have complained justifiably that every time you interview, you are on big regional press conference and you end up on the end of the news 5 nights in a row. Yeah. I'm just saying that there is, and again, this is because we in Belize are so fortunate to not have experienced many of those serious Category 5 storms that
as
we
yet.
Saw in the
yeah.
knock on everything, hold on to wood, but we haven't seen it as they did in Dominica or Antigua and Barbuda, that they saw some Category 4 and Category 5 storms tear up their islands. And we have very fortunately been spared that. So it's almost like we have a sense of invulnerability, and that is a myth. You believe the media is a very important part of changing the thinking and public, the approach in the public mind of how we see climate change.
Absolutely, and to communicate in a way that people understand. Because I was telling Ms. Al-Sal earlier that as scientists we have miserably failed
in that
aspect, because we tend to talk in a lingo that does not transmit information in a way that people can understand, by showing how climate change is impacting people's lives. Because recently there was floods down south in the Toledo district. Flooded out farms, flooded out people's homes, created hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars in damages. For those people, that's real. For the farmers who would have lost money, millions of dollars to droughts, that is real. And telling that story, I think it's very, very important. Because while the farmer does not care about 1.5 degrees Celsius or what is happening in the negotiations, what they want to be told is, look, you know what, next month it's projected that there's going to be a significant drought. And you are getting ready to plant, you shouldn't plant next month because you should wait. Those are very practical things that that somebody can relate to. Because they want to know tell me what I could do and help make it so that you provide some of the resources that we need so we can live with some of the effects like climate change. What do I mean? For example, if we have drought-resistant seeds for plants that you can grow, maybe you should stop using the ones that require a lot of water, because water is becoming scarce, and you use one that can tolerate less water. Those are the kinds of things. Now, the media's role in keeping this at the forefront, because Jules, you started out by saying, yes, it's not sexy and it's not as sensational as, say, some of the other stories that come at the front of your news. But this is the greatest threat, existential threat to humanity happening right now in climate change. So there cannot be a bigger issue, a bigger story. It's just that how we talk about it has been so aloof for so long.
So abstract,
that it doesn't resonate with people, and the media's role is to change that. And for them to change that, they have to understand it. They have to understand what is climate change and how it's working, and then bring the human element to the forefront. You see that story with the cemetery in Monkey River?
Right.
Those visuals are powerful, because for anybody who lives on a coastline and has land on a coastline and a house, do you know what's going to happen to that house in 20 years from now, 10 years from now, 5 years from now? Well, we have data that suggests what would potentially happen in terms of the rate of sea level rise. How do we find a way to communicate that to people? I think it's an absolute...
And make them believe it.
And make
because
them believe it.
We've been so spoiled in Belize for so long, knock on wood, that we really think that these things won't happen, and we keep just keeping on in that same way, an ignorant bliss.
And we also need to educate the young people, the youths who are on the verge of inheriting one of the most climate unjust planet ever. these, the people who are, you know, the teenagers today and the 5-year-old and 10-year-old, when they turn my age, the world is going to be a very different place from a climate point of view. The more these young people understand what their future holds for them from lack of global action, the more they can start to hold their political leaders all over the world more accountable. That is a key role of the media, to get that information out.
And then, finally, I'll just ask you to go over those 3 points again. You mentioned it earlier in the show, but just do it again. What are the 3 priority areas that Belize and the Caribbean hopes to come out of Glasgow, Scotland with?
One is that we hope that the world, the G20 in particular, would come up with plans, concrete plans, not paper plans, to cut global emissions by 45% relative to 2010 levels and has plans to reach net zero by 2050. It's called the mitigation gap, to keep 1.5 within reach. So to make that very simple, the first one, the world has to take actions to keep global temperatures below 1.5. The second one is that they have to scale up the amount of money that they've promised so that that can flow to countries so that we can adapt to the effects of climate change. They promised 100 billion. They have not met that promise. At Paris, at Glasgow, they have to demonstrate what's going to be done to get us that 100 billion and to ensure that there is a portion that is going to be earmarked for SIDS, countries like Belize.
Small Island Developing States.
And the third is that we have to agree on the rules, the rules of the Paris rule book, so that we can now get to the implementation of that agreement, which is what is needed to also keep 1.5 within reach. So those are the 3 big outcomes that we hope to get.
Okay, and with that, we'll end our show tonight, but we want to underscore that the media is very much attuned to this. You will be on Sun Up on 7 next Friday. I don't know if you've agreed, but I agree for you. Dr. Young will be on Sun Up on 7 next Friday, and the contingent of 30 thereabouts from Belize that is going to COP26 in Scotland includes Channel 7's Cherise Halsall, and other media practitioners, other journalists. And the idea is to have daily coverage of the meetings there in Scotland so that we can not only keep the public attuned, but bring the message home of climate change and that it is a real and present danger that we are living with. So please stay tuned to Channel 7 for that. In the coming weeks, we'll start reporting, Cherise Halsall will start reporting on November 1st from Scotland. And of course, we'll have all that coverage for you here on Channel 7. We want to say good night. We want to say thanks one last time to our sponsors, who, even though the weather may change, they are not fair weather friends. Bennett's Home Center, Belize Medical Associates, Belize Tax Services Department, they tax me so good. Cellular World, Creative Marketing, Mikado Textile Palettes, Ministry of Health and Wellness, Quickstop Finance Center. Thanks to all of them. And tune in next week to Uncut for another show. Good night.